And a good Wednesday evening to you, Darren McFarlane, Chris Pappas. MMA Tonight is the show. Every Wednesday night from 8 until 9 o'clock, we talk mixed martial arts with you, and we're excited about that. We follow the good folks at Slapshot Radio, Paul McCann, Pete Weber, and company. Next week, we'll be off, and then we'll be back around for 2013. Just a moment, we'll have a very special guest. CB Dollaway should join us. Ed is out of town this week, so he will rejoin us in the new year. Chris, how you doing?
I'm great. I'm having trouble with my chair and my headset here. I'm just not quite.
Can you not hear?
No. I can hear fine. It's just I'm my head shaved and something's sticking me in the head.
Right.
I don't have the flat top like you to block it.
The flat top, yes.
Yeah.
You would not work well in the camp up in Montreal. Was it TriStar?
Yeah.
Because they all have their hair parted over like Clark Kent.
Oh yeah.
Is that the new look in that gym, other than it's GSP?
It's French people, I don't know.
Everybody looks like Superman?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. No.
Although it didn't work out well on Saturday night for one of them, the Ultimate Fighter finale.
Yeah, which one?
What was it?
Ricci, Mike Ricci.
Yes.
Yeah, I forgot his name. Yeah, no, Ed got stuck somewhere. I mean, you know, Ed's big time. He kind of shows up when he can. You know, he probably, you know, I mean, one of his three cell phones, I was able to reach him today, and he was able to hook us up.
So do you have all the numbers?
Oh, yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. He's got several. I think he's like some sort of a secret agent, some sort of black ops guy maybe. You know, he's got different phones. I don't know, but, you know, he was able to get CB to come on with us, so it was good.
We're excited about that. In fact, I'm going to let you do the honors. I love his nickname. We're two dog guys, and I love his nickname. So I'm going to let you do the honors and bring CB in.
Well, CB Dollaway, you may remember from The Ultimate Fighter. I was reading up on him today a little bit. I think this is going to be his 10th or 11th UFC fight. So he's now a veteran. He's no longer the Ultimate Fighter CB Dollaway, but he fights in January down in Brazil, and excited to talk to him.
Let's bring in CB Dollaway. CB, good evening. Thanks for joining us.
What up?
So what's going on with you?
Just finished up training for the day, actually, about 5 minutes ago. Just got back to my house and get to relax a little bit and talk to you guys.
Well, we appreciate you making time for us tonight. What was that experience like going through The Ultimate Fighter?
It was a little nerve-wracking at first, you know. My whole life I've been a wrestler, and I've been doing MMA for about a year and just got an opportunity to go on The Ultimate Fighter. And I was like, yeah, this is awesome, you know, and you're just kind of thinking about all the everything of being on TV and everything that surrounds it. And then when you're going there, you're like, oh, yeah, like I'm going to fight real fighters now, you know, like UFC-level fighters. So it kind of set in. going there, you know, I definitely felt good about my chances, though, and just went and did the best I could, you know, with the little experience I had, and made it to the finals, but ended up getting caught in the finals against Amir, and, you know, just kind of showed me some holes in my game, and just been working on them ever since.
If memory serves me correct, was that not the one you didn't fight till, I think, the last one of the first round of fights in the house, right? I mean, I think you were frustrated by that. Is that correct?
Yeah, I kind of fought three times in 13 days, actually, because it's weird how they all, you know, how they film the show is not how it's perceived on TV. You're not fighting once a week. The whole show's filmed in 6 weeks, so there's a fight every 3 days.
Yeah,
and gets down, you know, to the quarterfinals and semifinals, the time is less and less in between your fights.
Which is never easy, especially if you're dealing with any form of injury.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. One of my fights, it was like my third fight in the house against Cale Yarbrough, like throwing some elbows on him and must have landed on his forehead or something that swelled my elbow up pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
I was kind of worried about that, but had to fight again, you know, like 3 or 4 days later.
So CB, so Rampage was your coach, right? Is that right?
Yeah.
You know, we had Matt Brown on a couple weeks ago, and I guess he was, you know, Rampage is from Tennessee, he's from Memphis, you know, just down the road, and, you know, he's got a lot of fans here, and you know, I know Rampage is a kind of an up and down kind of guy. You know, you never know kind of what you're going to get. But it seems like he really, you know, I mean, he admitted it. And he didn't really like doing the show. Did it show in his coaching as a fighter, or did his team at least give you, you know, at least some guidance during the show?
His team gave us work. You know, they were in there every day, and he tried to help out. He was more like motivational to us. You know, he was always there. He was always there for us, you know, and just talking to us and kind of sharing experiences with us and just kind of motivating us. So it was nice to have him there. It was more the coaches he brought in, like Zach Light and Junior Perez and some of the and the boxing guy he brought. You know, those were the guys who were actually doing most of the work with us. He would hop in, you know, from time to time, do a little bit of stuff. But, yeah, it was mostly his coaching staff taking care of the coaching.
So so you talked about Amir Sadala, and you know, you talked about how, you know, you had just started training in MMA. And, you know, as we talk about a lot, you know, that, you know, you were a wrestler, the striking aspect of it and the jiu-jitsu game are the two things that just only get better when you're young. And I'm sure is Amir a guy that you'd like to kind of fight again? Because, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, I'm sure your jiu-jitsu is a little better now.
Yeah, that's something in the past. You know, I'm not really that worried about it. I'm trying to move on to bigger and better things. You know, trying to make my way up in the middleweight division. He actually moved down to welterweight.
Yeah.
So I'm not really.
You don't want to cut that weight,
dude. I've toyed.
That's a big dog.
I've toyed with the idea. Yeah, it's my Doberman, Apollo.
Nice. Apollo. That's a great
name.
Yeah,
I've toyed with the idea of going down to welterweight, but it'd be a terrible cut for me. So.
So talk, you know. Talk about the guy you're fighting in January down in Brazil, and one, talk about him a little bit, and are you excited to get to Brazil? Have you ever been to Brazil? I have not.
No, I've never been. Actually fighting another finalist from The Ultimate Fighter, so it's kind of cool. You know, if I can take him out, kind of a little satisfaction there, you know, knowing I was able to beat another Ultimate Fighter finalist. Yeah, in Brazil, I'm super excited. Two of my coaches here at Power MMA and Fitness are natives of Brazil. I'm bringing one of them with me, Andre Maricaba. So he'll be down there, kind of tour guide and is serving as my coach at the same time. But yeah, he said where we're going in Brazil, Sao Paulo is like known for their food and stuff there. So pretty excited for after the fight.
Yeah, I was about to say, you probably can't do that before, huh?
You know, with my new trainer, Jason Kamens, he handles my diet and stuff.
Yeah.
He's been keeping me pretty close to weight.
Oh, cool.
So, you know, like last time I ate every day up and, you know, until the day of the actual weigh-in. So.
Yeah, that's great.
Have to enjoy the right foods.
So we had some fun today on Twitter with Ed Clay. And so follow CB at CB Dollaway. He was fun today. Darren, we kind of gave it to Ed a little bit since he wasn't here. So, just make sure you follow CB. He's a fun guy on Twitter.
So how does everything change, CB, for you? I mean, going through that whole experience and then, you know, going on the stage of the UFC, I've always wondered, you know, you're going through the Ultimate Fighter and you think about your wrestling background. You wrestled at Arizona State, so you were in the Pac-10, which is now the Pac-12, and moving up and then being on television and being in front of thousands of fans, is that serve as a distraction at all? I mean, do you think of that, or is that just it's no different than whether you're in the gym in front of, you know, the house for the Ultimate Fighter, or is it different when you know you're on what free TV, pay-per-view, and a crowd?
Oh, it's much different. It's much easier to fight in the Ultimate Fighter house when there's just no one around, really. It's just like the other teammates, a smaller crowd. You're not thinking about it. When you're actually at the UFC, you know, without, you know, 20,000 fans screaming and cheering, it's a much different aura, you know. I love it. It's great. But, yeah, it's a different beast going out there. You got to be able to deal with your nerves and the excitement of getting out there in front of everyone. And, yeah, it can mess with you at times, you know. Just, you know, making mental errors or something, just getting caught up in all of the hype and the TV cameras. And, yeah, there's a lot of adrenaline behind the scenes.
Do you have the same ritual before every fight, or do you change it up?
Not really. It's just, I don't know. Yeah, I guess kind of just go with the flow of what the UFC is having us do. You know, you're kind of on their schedule where they put you, and like I usually like to run some sprints and stuff before my fights, but, you know, sometimes you're not able to, and there's not room back there, you know, but I always try to find a hallway or something, but they kind of restrict your access a little. They don't want you getting out mixed in with the fans and stuff, or going out the wrong door and not being able to get back in. they keep an eye on you a little bit, and, you know, they definitely try to work with you, though, and accommodate you as much as they can.
Oh, man. So, you know, we like to ask guys this. Who's your, I guess, your favorite fighter to watch now? If there's a pay-per-view event and, you know, who's maybe your top guy that you're like, well, I want to make sure I'm home Saturday night or out somewhere to watch this guy fight, besides yourself, even though you can't watch yourself. It'd be kind of hard.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's generally like Vanderlei Silva. You know, that's who I watch, you know, getting into the sport. I just love how the guy fights. He comes out, you know, somebody's probably getting finished. You know, and maybe him, but usually it's the other guy, you know, but he comes out and brings it every time. And, you know, just especially his days in Pride, I just loved watching him fight.
What was it like fighting fighting Mayhem? I mean, that's a guy that's been around a long time, and obviously he's had some unique things happen to him. But what was it like fighting? Because we had heard there was some sort of issue backstage with him after the fight, and I don't know if you saw any of that or not, but what was that experience like?
The actual fight or everything leading up to the fight?
All of the above.
Yeah, I guess all of the above.
Leading up to the fight, you know, he's just like, I don't know if it was a good, I kind of now see it as a good thing, but yeah, I mean, he's talking a lot of smack leading up to the fight, saying stuff on Twitter, saying he's going to retire if he loses to me, you know, like, he sucks, I'm not going to lose to this guy, just like, personally attacking me, and it was just kind of made me like grow a hatred for him. Like, I hated him. Going, there was no problem for me every day to wake up, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning, go out, get my road work in, go to practice, go to spike. Getting in there, I was like chomping at the bit to get in there with him and, you know, beat him, make him eat his words.
Well, you retired him, right?
Yeah. You know, but it was just, you know, it's good to have an opponent like that, looking back on it, because it's, you know, it's hard sometimes to get motivated, but having an opponent like that is no problem at all.
Well, I can tell you this, CB, I'll speak for me and not for Chris. I was definitely rooting for you. We had him come through Nashville back on the Strikeforce card. In fact, it was the last CBS card that they put on here in Nashville, last one they put on, period, at the Bridgestone Arena, and he was fighting Tim Stout. We had all the prelim activities, the workouts over at Ed Clay's gym, and they asked me to get up there and kind of a little dog and pony show for the media, for the fans, and introduce the fighters and talk about them. And I had some paper that Strikeforce had given me to, you know, just kind of look off for some of these fighters. And when I was talking about him, he grabbed, do you remember this, Chris? He grabbed the paper out of my hand, wadded it up, threw it out of the ring, and just really tried to, you know, he was being a real jerk. And I went with it, but afterwards, I was like, I'm not rooting for that guy again. He's not one of my favorites.
Kind of his MO, man. That's kind of the way he is.
Yeah, I don't get it how he has his show, Bully Beatdown.
They canceled it.
And he's like, tries to be like the biggest bully out there.
That's a good point.
You know what I mean? I don't get
it. That's a really good point.
Well, CB, we certainly appreciate, and we'll be rooting for you again on your next fight on January the 19th, UFC on Fox. And thanks for making some time to join us tonight after your workout, and hopefully we'll get to catch up with you soon.
Sweet. I appreciate it, guys. Look forward to next time.
All right.
Take care.
CB, appreciate it.
CB Dalloway.
Later.
He is a really good guy. He faces Daniel Serafin.
It's close enough.
Serafin.
I have no idea.
UFC on Fox. Wow. Or if it's FX.
Is this the party rock anthem?
I like it, though. Good way to go out. We'll come back if you want to jump in there. 737-1025. Talk anything in the MMA world. Certainly a lot of things going on this time of year. You're listening to MMA Tonight right here on 102.5 The Game. 8:18 is the time. Back here on MMA Tonight, 102.5 The Game. Darren McFarland and Chris Pappas with you every Wednesday from 8 to 9, talking mixed martial arts. Ed Clay out of town. He'll rejoin us in the new year. We hope so. Well, I guess. We will not be on next week because of the holidays. But Austin Huff back behind the glass, spinning the tunes. But hopefully Ed will be back in January with us. But we appreciate CB Dollaway for joining us. And he will be on the UFC on FX card, which will have Vitor Belfort and Michael Bisping as the main event. He will be the fight before that one with Daniel Serafian. So it's a good story, good guy. And I'll tell you what, we've had some – I don't know if you've thought about this since we've started this back up.
Mm-hmm.
Last week we had Pat Barry.
Yeah.
Tremendous fight Saturday night.
Oh, yeah.
Gets the knockout.
Matt Brown's fight
was
good.
And how great is Pat Barry to talk to? The week before that, we had Matt Brown. He won.
Yep.
Clay Guida the week before that. Those have been our three guests. Did Clay win?
He doesn't fight until he fights on the Chicago.
That's right.
Fox
That's right.
Card,
That's right.
Next
he was
month.
At a Bulls game.
Yeah.
When we talked to him. But so far, we're 2-0. On our guest, and
that's
I
how
like
should, that's
CB's
how I tell
chances.
The guys to come on, yeah.
I like CB's chances. Let's go out to Clarksville before we get
yeah,
into
give
some
that
things.
Phone number out.
73. Thank you, Chris. 737-1025. Let's go to Brian in Clarksville. Brian, you're up first. Good evening.
Hey,
how you doing?
What's going on, man?
How you doing?
Just wanted to touch base with y'all on the Velasquez and Dos Santos fights. I know that last time they fought, Dos Santos had said something about a knee injury, and then now Velasquez is saying that he had a knee injury also. You know, you think the outcome of this fight, you know, both guys are just kind of going to be like, you know, look, we're both healthy now, you know, and I won't see any more injuries, you know, and just, you know, whoever wins, you know, just call it that.
Yeah, well, you know, Kane's a good guy. Kane, I mean, they both are. Kane didn't really say anything about it until a video came out that showed kind of the injury that he had, which it didn't look that good. So, but, you know, he got hit in the side of the head, so I'm not sure what his knee did. But, you know, it probably did affect him somewhat. And, you know, every MMA fighter that goes into a fight is typically injured. But, you know, the thing is, though, is that Kane is a lot better fighter than what he showed in that fight, so I would expect a much better fight this time. You know, Junior Dos Santos is very good. I mean, the speed he has with his hands at that size is pretty impressive. His ability to stop a takedown is pretty impressive. But, you know, before Kane lost that fight, we were talking about him as a five-tool guy. I mean, you know, you kind of talk about how he doesn't have much of a weakness. I mean, the guy's got really good boxing. He's a top-level wrestler. Got good cardio, so... You know, it could be, you know, hopefully it's a lot better fight this time, and I think it will be. And I think Kane, you know, is probably not being given enough of a chance by some people. They just assume that Dos Santos is going to run right through him again, and that's probably a poor assumption to make.
Yeah, is there what other names, you know, are going to be out there? Of course, Overeem, you know, is there any names as far as under the radar that you might see that might slip into a title shot?
Well,
what about Fedor? What's he doing these days?
Fedor? Well, his brother retired today. yeah, I mean, you know, the heavyweight division is not lacking talent. I mean, you know, Overeem is probably the guy that's, I mean, I'm pretty sure they said is going to get the shot of the winner. You know,
where does Roy Nelson fit into all this?
You know, Roy
Nelson. Because they keep throwing him out there and he keeps winning.
Yeah, well, until he fought Dos Santos. And then,
well,
you
true.
Know, he,
but nobody's beat that guy.
Right, and, you know, he gave Dos Santos a pretty good fight. You know, I mean, Nelson has lost some weight. He's not as big as he was. You know, he's got – the guy's got skills. He really does.
He had a tremendous knockout of Matt Mitrione.
He does, and, you know, and Mitrione was fighting on short notice, and that's fine. But, you know, I mean, Roy could get another shot, I guess. You know, but he's just I just don't think he's – I think Roy's the kind of guy that's literally a very, very he's an above-average fighter. I don't think he's a great fighter, like Dos Santos, Cain Velasquez, you know those guys are. So, you know, but it'll be interesting to see what happens heavyweight. I think John Jones is going to move to heavyweight, you know, late next year, you know, at least by 2014. He's certainly big enough to do it, And I think there's a lot more matchups for him because he's kind of cleaning out that 205 division. Not a lot of guys there that I'm really worried about. You know, Henderson maybe, Gustafsson might be a fun fight, but, you know, that's a guy that I think will probably move up sometime late next year.
And just one more thing. You think if Velasquez does indeed win in two Saturdays, do you see a possibility of Big Nog maybe campaigning to, for a title run? You know, I don't really see him getting an instant title shot, you know, but maybe one, you know, I know he had said that he wouldn't fight Dos Santos, but, you know, maybe if Velasquez was champ, he'd, he'd change his mind.
I don't think
so. Hey, thanks for the call, Brian.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Yeah, I think Big Nog's time has passed. You know, as with most fighters, except for Anderson Silva and Randy Couture to an extent, you know, as you age, it's a lot tougher to compete. And the problem that Big Nog, I think, would have is that, you know, every time you get knocked out, and this is the same for any sport, it's easier to get knocked out the next time. And that's just the way that the brain works. And that guy's been knocked out a few times. You know, Frank Mir broke his arm. You know, I think he's been through enough battles. You know, I think his body's probably finally starting to kind of wear down. You know, he's getting up there in age. So I don't think I'd see him, you know, make another run at it. I mean, you know, stranger things have happened. But I'm going to guess it's going to be Overeem. And then you're going to have, you know, the loser of that fight still around and loser of the fight two Saturdays around. You have John Jones come up.
Speaking of heavyweights.
Yeah.
You know, we had CB Dollaway on to start off the show. The fight before his on that UFC on FX card in January. Gabriel Gonzaga. Is fighting Ben Rothwell? What's Gonzaga been doing? I didn't even know he was still fighting.
I don't remember, but Gonzaga hangs around and, you know.
He hasn't fought in over a year. Yeah. And he's been out of the UFC, right?
I don't remember. I don't know.
I thought he fought a couple times outside the UFC, came back like a year ago and fought one fight in the UFC. And that was the last time I've heard from him. He's on this card.
Some people love heavyweight fights. Gonzaga, Chuck Congo, Matt Mitrione, Roy Nelson. All those guys usually put on exciting fights. Somebody either gets knocked out or they get knocked out. Pat Barry is the same way. He either knocks somebody out.
His post-game
or he gets knocked out.
Fight interview was awesome with Joe Rogan.
Yeah, it was. And Pat's a good guy.
He's like, I'm going down no matter what. I'm going down with a victory. I'm going down.
And that's true.
It is true.
I mean, the one thing you say about Pat Barry's fights is that they're never boring.
No.
And to me, I like watching that more than I like watch George St. Pierre lay on top of somebody for five rounds. It's more fun for me. You know, is Pat Barry going to get a title shot at the heavyweight division? I mean, probably not. But, I mean, he keeps knocking people out like that, he will. You know, I mean, you got to think about it. The fights that Pat Barry has lost, you know, the Congo fight, for example. I mean, Congo looked like a zombie. I mean, I thought he was done. And so did Pat Barry. You know, he went rushing in a little too wide open, and
he talked about it.
Congo woke up and hit him once. You know, I mean, a lot of Pat Barry's losses have come in fashion where he could have easily won those fights. So if that guy can put together a few big knockouts and his ground game continues to get better,
that's a good win, by the way. Rosario is no joke.
No, he's not. You know, he's a guy, and you know, I was a little shocked about his cardio. You know, he looked tired pretty quickly. And Pat really took advantage of that and really laid it to him. I mean, Pat Barry's kicks are just nasty.
Yeah.
I mean, nasty.
And they were working.
Yeah.
Before he made Shane go night-night.
I think of the Joey Beltran fight when he was just kicking that guy's leg over and over again. I don't know how it wasn't going down. I tell people all the time, you know, to ask about training or getting hit in the face or whatever. The worst pain I've ever felt is getting kicked in the leg. A tight kick to my thigh over and over again. You can knock me out any day of the week. I'm asleep. It doesn't matter. Getting kicked in the leg, you don't walk right for a few days. And a guy like Pat with Pat Barry's sized legs hitting you in your thigh as hard as he can, I mean, just think about when someone punches you in the thigh, you know, as a joke, how that feels. Imagine a 240-pound man with tree trunk legs kicking you in the thigh.
Well, if you can hear it on television, you know
it's
not anything you want to mess with. You can hear that popping sound.
No.
Or slapping, whatever. I mean, it's pretty. It's almost It's so distinct. It's like hearing the ping of the aluminum bat in college baseball.
And, I mean, you do get used to it. I mean, it doesn't hurt as much over time, but it never feels good at all.
We'll step away. We'll take another break here on MMA Tonight, and we'll come back with more phone calls. Maybe catch up with Jack Bratcher from Pro MMA Now. We'll do that next here on 102.5 The Game. Tunes behind the glass. 8:32 is the time. MMA Tonight is the show. We do this every Wednesday night from 8 to 9. Darren McFarlane, Chris Pappas, no Ed Clay this week.
Oh,
he's traveling.
He's in Maryland if you can find him.
What is he doing in Maryland?
He'll be wearing sunglasses even though it's nighttime.
Oh, that's right. He's on tour.
Is that where he is?
Bring in Jack Bratcher from Pro MMA Now. If you haven't checked out this website, you should, right? It's a must check out, if that's something we can say. It's a must check out if you're an MMA fan. He does a great job, and he puts up this show on the site, chronicles everything we do here on Wednesday nights, and we appreciate that. Jack, good evening. How you doing?
Hey, thanks for the intro, Darren. I appreciate that.
No problem.
I'm good, man.
What did you think about the card? And in fact, MMA fans are getting a treat. We've been talking about this the last couple of weeks. You've had Fox, you had FX, you've got a couple more around the corner. These free fights, is this a good idea around the holidays?
Yeah, it kind of seems like they're trying to end out the year, you know, cramming in, getting everybody's fights in before the end of the year. And I really enjoyed the Tough 16 finale with Roy and Mitrione and all those guys. I thought it was great.
Hey, you know, Jack, I had a debate this morning on Twitter with Jeremy Botter, who's a Bleacher Report writer. He used to work for Heavy.com, I think. And he was talking about Ronda Rousey and her headlining the UFC 157 show. And you know, we've had Ronda on, and she's awesome, so funny, great for the sport. But she's headlining a pay-per-view show, and you know, I'm not sure I'm convinced yet, unless she's fighting a cyborg, that she's going to do what they think she's going to do, headlining a UFC event, mainly because, for me, she's just going to armbar someone again in 60 seconds. What say you? Do you think the casual fans will, if they promote it right, will pay the $55 to watch Ronda fight someone that they know she's probably going to beat?
It's going to be interesting for sure. And it's a little hard to say, but I think she does have that crossover power with it. You know, she's already done a ton of mainstream media that other people haven't done. She was on Jim Rome's, I believe it was his first show on Showtime when he debuted with his new show on there.
That's correct.
So she's doing all this big stuff, and I think it'll get a ton of publicity. I think she'll do it.
What do you think changed Dana White's mind? Because he was so reluctant about going down this path, and now he's all in. I mean,
well, that's not really. He had said that he needed the vision to fill out more before he went, but you know, he needed a star. I mean, and he, you know, Gina Carano could have been that, but she went to do movies to me, and you know, Ronda's got that it factor. She's funny, you know. She's
good looking.
Yeah, I mean, and she's, you know, she's got that. You know, and I think Jack's right. I mean, you know, I think she was on Jimmy Fallon once or Jimmy Kimmel, one of the late night shows. You know, she's been on a couple of those. I think if the UFC is able to get her on those shows again to promote it, it'd be good. Like, personally, I'd rather watch Henderson and Machida fight on that card.
But they're going to have to continue to beef up that card, right? I don't believe everything has been announced. That fight has been announced. I think Uriah Faber has been announced. But they're going to have to put a couple more
attractive
fights, right?
You got Hendo and Machida, Uriah Faber fighting. You got Ronda Rousey. I mean, I think that's good enough. I mean, don't you think so, Jack?
Probably. It definitely wouldn't hurt if they could get a couple more big fights, but I think she'll do a lot on her own. And as far as why, you know, what made him come around, I think being around her, he seemed to have got very close with her. They were going to different events and stuff together and just seeing what she did to her opponents too, you know. Misha Tate was so hyped coming in, and she just dominated her opponent so quickly and easily. I think she just kind of won him over.
So what did you think about the Ultimate Fighter finale? Colton Smith defeats Mike Ricci. What did you think, and what's in store for Colton Smith? Certainly, he's an easy guy to root for.
Yeah, that was actually the one fight I picked wrong on that card. I thought Ricci, you know, coming from an awesome camp and all that. I wasn't a big fan of the season this year. I just couldn't really get into it. But Colton Smith looked amazing.
He really did.
And, yeah, he seems
go
like
America.
He could probably do something.
Yeah, and Clark Kent lost in their camp. They had to have been saddened by that. What do you think about that camp? Certainly you have GSP, you've got Roy McDonald, who we talked about, who's his star is certainly on the rise, and you thought, well, I guess everybody that comes out of that camp, they're just going to fall in line and be the next superstar, and yet Colton Smith had his way with him. Yes, it was a decision, but he really dominated the fight.
Yeah, you called him Clark Kent. I think he looks just like Jake Gyllenhaal.
He does a little bit of that too, yep.
Well, I mean, they called him the accountant when he walked in, you know. They thought he looked like an accountant.
His partner is Inspector Gadget, you know, Roy McDonald. So, that camp, you know, undoubtedly they got some great talent there, but, you know, your training partners can't get in there and fight for you. So it is what it is, you know. Anybody can, with the right training and preparation, can beat you.
So what do you have on the radar at Pro MMA now?
Well, just winding down the year here, just got done with XFC, you know, coming to town. They put on a great, great show, and Mick Newell won the title. So we're actually still editing some post-fight interviews from that card, almost done with that, but just going to kind of got UFC 155 coming up and wind out the year with that and get ready for the new year.
Well, we appreciate everything you guys do for this show and have done over the years, and it's always good to catch up with you, and we'll check in from time to time with you, Jack.
Hey, appreciate it, guys. Anytime.
Thanks, right, Jack. Jack Bratcher, Pro MMA Now. Check out their site. They do a tremendous job of covering the sport, and that's right, the XFC card was here a couple of Fridays ago, and Mike Newell did win the championship. It's a good story.
It is. It's he poses an interesting – You know, when you look at game planning and you look at trying to figure, you know, figure things out in any sport, you know, when I watch him fight, it's different. You cannot train for somebody like that. It's hard to kind of figure out, you know, how to defend certain things, how to, even your stance. I mean, a lot of things. But I'd be curious to hear, you know, I think we might be going to a break, but
yeah,
if
throw
people
it back
wanna,
out there.
Well, you know, I'd like to hear people, just casual fans driving around. If you've heard of Ronda Rousey, even if you're just a kind of a casual fan, is you know, watching her on pay-per-view, is that something you'd pay to see? You know, pay $55 and just give us a buzz at, what's the number, Darren?
737-1025. I would like to.
I'd be curious to hear
that.
Because I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe the casual fan won't buy it. I know for a cyborg fight or a fight in Gina Carano, I just don't know about fighting a random person that she's probably going to armbar in a minute. I don't know.
She does have a track record of doing that.
Brock
yes.
Lesnar did it.
Yeah,
so we'll see.
We'll step away. Our final break. You're listening to MMA Tonight here on 102.5 The Game. think? UFC 157 in February out in Anaheim, California at the Honda Center. Dana White has not only started up a female division with his headliner Ronda Rousey, he has put her on the main card. And as of right now, it's the second to last fight of the evening. Dan Henderson and Machida will be the final fight of the night. But what do you think about putting a female fight on the main card in the UFC? Is that going to work? Is that going to sell tickets? Is that going to sell pay-per-view buys? Or does it matter? Is it just kind of an extra fight that everybody can watch? And you were kind of hinting, Chris, that, let's be honest, I mean, her fight's all in the same way. I mean, they're dynamic. And they're fun, and she's going to hype it up, and she's a pretty face, and she's a good talker.
But, you know, a casual fan's probably not going to care as much, really, about that. It's kind of like a Brock Lesnar type effect, or even a Kimbo Slice. They get kind of attracted to the attraction, and, you know, they just want to see it. You know, now, will that last, you know, three or four times? No, but, you know, I think eventually she'll fight Cyborg, and you know, the competition will start to kind of increase. We'll see. I don't know.
737-1025, 737-1025. Kevin in Springfield, you're up next. Kevin, welcome in.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Good. How are you?
Pretty good. Anyway, as far as Ronda Rousey is concerned, I think against Kamuch, I look at it as it can make the main card. It's for a title and everything. But as far as a main event, co-main event, I think she needs to fight once or twice, let the casual fans find out who she is, and then maybe a co-main event with Cyborg. I'm not even sure if I would put her as a main event with even with Cyborg. It's kind of a, you know, it's kind of a big step for women's MMA. I think she needs a little more notoriety with a casual fan base first.
Yeah, see, I thought you would ease her in by putting her on one of these Fox cards or FX cards where she can get some exposure and have maybe, I mean, the diehards, they know who she is, but the casual fans, I mean, they're trying to constantly grow the sport and let the casual fans learn about Ronda Rousey. But to kind of throw her on the main card of a pay-per-view, I don't know. I mean, who am I? Dana White's certainly smarter than me on growing the sport. But
he hasn't called you?
He hasn't. No, probably never will. But he's been on the show many times, and we appreciate that.
It's been a while, but yeah.
Well, I mean, is that what you're thinking, Kevin?
I agree with that. Actually, I didn't think about that right away, but putting her on a TV card, FX, or even Fox, you know, not the main event necessarily, but on the card where people can see her.
Right.
I believe that's an excellent idea, actually. That's even better than just putting her on the card as a main card fight, period. So, yeah,
Did you get a chance to see the fights on Saturday?
Yes, definitely.
And what did you think?
I like the fights. Roy Nelson, he surprised me every time. You know, he doesn't look like he'd be skilled, but he's so much more skilled than he looks. And as far as the tough finale, Colton fought a good fight. He did what he needed to win, but that's just not my kind of fight. It goes back to what the other gentleman said about GSP. I'm a big GSP fan, but honestly, I'd rather see him get knocked out or knock somebody else out. I don't want to see another five-round decision. It's kind of the same way with Colton. He kind of just smothered him and didn't really let him do a whole lot, and I wasn't too happy with that. I mean, like I said, he did fight a good fight. He did what he needed to win, but it just wasn't really my cup of tea.
Yeah, it made me think, and Chris, jump in here and tell me if you agree or not. It's almost like he was throwing their style back in their face, and I don't know if that's true or not, but to the point, it's almost like the roles were reversed. That's what you expected out of Ricci, but instead, Colton was the one on top and controlling the fight and dictating everything that was happening.
Well, you know, Colton is a wrestler. That's what he is. That's what he does. He's a ground and pound guy. He was a military guy. Ricci, even though he fights, you know, in that gym, is really not like GSP. I mean, he's more of a, you know, he's more of a stand up style. It's not really a wrestler. You know, he that's something that was kind of exposed for him. So, yeah, I mean, Colton's one of those guys he's a tough out. He's like a pusher in tennis. You know, no matter what you throw at him, they're going to just throw it back at you. He's not going to be dynamic. He may not finish you, but he's going to beat you up. And that's what he did. And, you know, I mean, the guy's, you know, been in wars. I mean, he's a tough guy. It's not going to bother him to get in a cage. You know,
As he said, this is the easy part.
Yeah,
on exactly. Saturday night. You get the last word, Kevin.
Yeah, as far as that goes, I understand what you're saying as far as throwing it back at him. But if you go back to the show, to me, he pretty much did every single one of his fights the same way. I think what was just said about him being a wrestler, that is what he is. And he seems to really just depend on that more than anything. And I don't know. I just, like I said, it's not really my thing. It frustrates me more with GSP because I'm a big fan of his. Just simply because I know he has a whole lot more skills than just that. So, and that's all I got, guys. Thanks for taking my call.
Hey, thanks. Have a great evening.
Appreciate it.
I'm a big fan, too, and looking forward to some of the fights here just around the corner. And I think it's going to – 2012, I think we learned some things. One, as the sport has grown, we've talked about this. You have to deal with injuries. You have to deal with people testing positive and sitting out a year. So you're going to lose people that way. And while it's growing and it's on demand and everybody wants you to come to their city and their arena, whether it's in the States or in other countries, you have to keep letting the fans want more. And if it seems like there's something there every weekend, you're really diluting the product. And I think they need to scale back. They know that. They're going to, I think, better things on the horizon.
Yeah, I mean, the UFC had 34 events scheduled in 2012. I don't know exactly how many they actually had. I know one got canceled. I don't know if that many ended up getting scheduled, but that was their hope. That's too many. You know, the injury part is, I mean, there's not much we can do about it. You know, Dana's asked maybe that the week leading up to the fight or the 2 weeks leading up to the fight, that training camps kind of tone it down a little bit, and maybe they can do that. I don't know. It's tough because, you know, just like football players, just like baseball players, I mean, if you're going to get out and play baseball and you're going to get out and play football, you got to practice football and you got to practice baseball. I mean, it's the same in MMA. You've got to practice MMA, and, you know, things happen. And I think that spotlight was brighter because of how many shows they had, and therefore there were more injuries. But, you know, their roster's big. They got a lot of fighters on the roster that all want to fight. They've got Fox now that wants fights on FX. They want fights on Fuel. You still got the pay-per-view fights. So, I mean, they're still going to have a lot of fights, but, I think they're definitely going to, reduce them somewhat next year and hope for the best with injuries, because it was one of the worst years in a very long time, injury-wise. I mean, at one time you had like four champions hurt at the same time, and it sucked. It wasn't fun, yeah. You know. I mean, Anderson Silva had to go down to Brazil and fight, Stefan Bonner because of injuries. I mean, Anderson Silva doesn't need to be fighting Stefan Bonner. I mean, there's just no reason.
Stefan Bonner's a fun fight, not against Anderson Silva.
Well, it's just not worth the risk of him getting hurt or doing something bad. I mean, you know, Anderson Silva at this stage of his career needs to be fighting super fights, because that's what we want to see. You know, he's 38 years old. He doesn't have a lot of time left. We know he's the greatest of all time. You know, let's see him fight.
Are you of the belief that he'll never fight GSP?
No.
Those two will never fight?
No.
What's more likely, Jones or GSP?
I think GSP. I think GSP is more likely.
Really?
Yeah, because, Jones and Anderson, have said themselves that they will never fight each other. Now, of course that can change. They've never, GSP and Silva have never said that. It's been more about, GSP got hurt. GSP has always said that he wanted to put on a little more weight and get a little bigger, which I think he's done now. Honestly, it doesn't seem like GSP wants to fight Anderson Silva. At least it doesn't seem that way. But money talks. You're talking about, you put that fight together, they're not going to be getting paid boxer-type money, but it's going to be a lot closer than it has been.
How do you think, because we don't have a show next week and we'll be back in January of 2013 on that Wednesday, how do you think Dos Santos Velasquez? I can't imagine. You remember when Cain Velasquez, I mean, there was a time, and we had him on the show many times, he was a machine. I mean, everybody thought he was the perfect fighting machine, and nobody was going to beat him, and Junior Dos Santos did, so... Are you telling me that you think there's no way he beats him twice?
No, I'm not saying that, but I think it's going to be a much better fight. I think what happens is that, Cain got caught. I mean, if you – I'm not giving anyone tips on how to fight, but, if you hit someone behind the ear, that doesn't necessarily knock you out, but it knocks your equilibrium off. And that's what happened to Kane. You know, it was a perfect punch. He hit him in the back of the ear, basically, and that gives you almost kind of vertigo. And you could see that with Kane, and then that was it. That happens. That's happened to, you know, all the great fighters except for Anderson Silva. I mean, you know, you get caught sometimes. You know, Kane, I saw the video of that knee injury, and it didn't look good. So that makes it that made it tough for him to execute his game plan. You know, I mean, he couldn't, you know, try to get DeSantos down on the ground. Although Kane's a very good boxer, he's not at the level of Junior Dos Santos. I think it's going to be a heck of a war. I really do. If they're both healthy, they both can go out there. I think it's going to be a war because Kane is no joke. Kane is still very, very, very good, and it would not shock me at all if he won this fight. It wouldn't shock me at all. I mean, I may even pick him. I don't know yet. You know, it's not even Christmas yet. I have too much to think about. But, you know, it's not going to shock me if Cain Velasquez, his hand is raised, and he's the UFC champion again. It's not going to shock me at all. The guy's a stud.
I don't know how you could pick against that guy again.
Yeah, but, you know, DeSantos is a stud too. I mean, these are two thoroughbreds that are going to go at each other.
No, I just remember, man, when he was coming up through the ranks, and I know he's fought and won since that loss, but, I mean, we all thought he was the perfect fighting machine. He could not lose.
Yeah, you're right.
Chris, have a Merry Christmas.
You too.
Appreciate it as always, and a Happy New Year.
Ho, ho, ho.
We'll talk to you in 2013. See. Same to you, DJ Huff behind the glass, and everybody out there listening. You've been listening to MMA Tonight on 102.5 The Game.